Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for tuning in. I do appreciate you tuning in to this new episode of I'm coming out with, which is going to be the first episode of a multi-part series, which is going to be discussing the Saudi intervention in Yemen. And I will be arguing in defense of that. The first part of this series will be discussing the point that the Saudi intervention is both legal and supported by the recognized and legitimate government of Yemen and by the international community and also by the regional community. Recently, I came across an article that concerned me and inspired me to start this multi-part series. I had wanted to discuss why the Saudi intervention in Yemen was legitimate and was correct, but I didn't have a point to start off of. This started sometime after I had debated, as you know, the Phantom on YouTube on Henry's channel. Regarding the Saudi intervention in Yemen. He was arguing against it, and I was arguing for it. I've decided to start this multi-part series, and I'm glad that you're all tuning in. So, let's begin. I'm going to share the screen now with you so we can begin reviewing some of these articles. The first point that we're going to look at is this article right here. This is from the Washington Examiner, and this is the article that inspired me to want to talk about the Yemeni intervention, supporting it, after reading this article, which was a negative against it. So the title of this article is Senators Rand Paul, Bernie Sanders, and Mike Lee issue joint resolution to put Yemeni people before profits. Really? This is from the Washington Examiner. It's written by Christopher Chmogli. He does have a Twitter, as you can see right here, and is described on Muckrack as a commentator, Washington Examiner, who has written numerous different articles as a freelance journalist. Freelance. So, last week, Kentucky Senator Rand Paul decided to take a stand against Saudi Arabia. That's okay. That's dumb. He was joined by Senator Bernie Sanders of Vermont and Mike Lee of Utah. Together, they issued a joint resolution of disapproval to block the proposed U.S. arms sales to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Very dumb. According to the press release, this weapons sale to Saudi Arabia included 280 air-to-air missiles and 596 missile launchers. Other sophisticated weapons were included, as well as associated training and support. The entire cost was estimated to be about approximately $650 billion. $650 billion that the U.S. taxpayers could use. But, of course, Rand Paul and Sanders and Mike Lee don't want that. The three senators were not pleased at all, not in the slightest. No duh, they're isolationists. As the Saudi government continues to wage its devastating war in Yemen, false and repress its own people, they're modernizing and we should be rewarding we should not be rewarding them with more arms sales. Wrong. Senator Sanders said in the press release, the war in Yemen is a humanitarian tragedy and the U.S. participation in this war remains undeclared by Congress. The administration's proposed arms sales to Saudi Arabia contradicts the president's own stated policy. I am proud to once again stand with my colleagues and push back on the unconstitutional support of this war. Wrong, Senator. As usual, Senator Rand Paul had an especially scathing rebuke of the deal. A message needs to be sent to Saudi Arabia that we don't approve of their war with Yemen. Senator Paul, the war is not with Yemen. The war is with the Houthis and with Iran. By participating in this sale, we would not only be rewarding reprehensible behavior from who, but also exacerbating a humanitarian crisis in Yemen caused by the Houthis. I urge Congress and the Biden administration to consider the possible consequences of this sale. that could accelerate an arms race in the Middle East and jeopardize the security of our military technologies. Whose fault is that, Senator Paul? Is it Saudi Arabia's or is it Iran's? Iran's, obviously, duh. Previously, the Biden administration declared plans to cease support in the war in Yemen. He cited ending the war in Yemen as an integral part of his foreign policy, the president. However, little action has been taken to put that plan into action. As such, Saudi Arabia has continued its full blockade in Yemen, which is worse than the humanitarian crisis in the country. They are not blocking Yemen. They are blocking the Houthis, and they are blocking the Iranians. They are working with the legitimate government of Yemen. The blockade is jeopardizing the flow of food to as many as 13 million people, according to the Reuters. I'm sorry, but blocking aid, they're not blocking food. They're trying to block weapons for getting to the Houthis. The three senators deserve a lot of credit for issuing this resolution. Yeah, right. By permitting the sale, the United States would be enabling the humanitarian crisis in Yemen. As many people in the country starve, Saudi Arabia has lit a fuel bucket of Yemen, preventing food and water from getting to the people who desperately need them. False, false, and false. Senator Rand Paul continues to put conscience over profit. Yeah, right. And this time he was able to get Bernie Sanders and Mike Lee to join in. able to get Mike Lee and to join in. Yeah, like that's really a freaking big deal. I mean, seriously, it's not an accomplishment to get people like Senator Bernie Sanders and Senator Mike Lee to buy into a non-interventionist message. I mean, sorry, that's just not that hard, because they're all isolationists at the end of the day. I mean, it's so ridiculous what this article's whole premise and statement. I'm going to include it in the chat so you all can take a look at, well, actually, no, I'm not even going to include it in the chat. You've seen it. I don't think you need to read any more of that drivel from Christopher Chimogli. I'm actually going to tweet something to this guy, Christopher Chimogli. I actually will probably challenge him to a debate just because of the nonsense spewed in that ridiculous hit piece that was just completely false. I mean, it just doesn't make any sense for people to come out and try to praise this non-interventionist, isolationist positions that have just been the ruin of the region and the ruin of essentially of Yemen, caused by the Houthis and caused by the Iranians, not by the Saudis. But once again, these people don't know what they're talking about. So let's go back to sharing the screen so we can review the next article. But also, so we can just go here to Twitter, and I'm just going to say to this, I read your absolute hit piece on the legitimate and legal and just Saudi intervention in Yemen. Care to debate the issue on my channel sometime? And I'm going to include the link so that way he knows what I'm talking about. And just for good measure, I'm going to add isolationist to that. And we need to put this point out: stop Houthi terrorism in Yemen. And I'll also add the point, Yemen can't wait. And it can't wait because the Houthis keep bringing up this problem. And I'm looking forward to, looking for. I'm actually looking forward to potentially debating this person. And I think that this is pretty good. And I'm going to send that out. And we'll see if he gives a response. But this is this guy, ladies and gentlemen, and an absolute hit piece. So let's go back to the topic. And let's start first with this next article. So, the extent and validity of Yemen's consent to the U.S.'s use of force. This is from Just Security website. So let's begin reading. Although Article 2.4 of the UN Charter prohibits members from threatening or using force against another member, there are certain exceptions that may apply to U.S. military involvement in Yemen, such as the Yemeni government's consent. So we have right here in this case where if a nation consents to force being used in its nation, then therefore it does not prohibit another member going into the country to deal with that issue. So let's review the exceptions. Because as we all know, you can't just go into a legitimate government's nation without some legality. So Article 2.4 of the UN Charter and associated exceptions states, all members shall refrain in their international relations from the threat or use of force against the territorial integrity or political independence of any state or in any other manner inconsistent with the purposes of the United Nations. There are three exceptions to this blanket prohibition. A host state may consent to the use of force, which is the case of Yemen. A state may use force in self-defense under Article 51 of the Charter. And a state may use force if authorized to do so by the UN Security Council. So there's three different measures right there. State requests help from an outside source, which is Yemen, who requested Saudi assistance. A state may use force in self-defense. So if you're attacked illegitimately, you have a right to defend yourself. And a state may use force if authorized to do so by the UN Security Council, meaning that if the UN Security Council votes for authorization, then it can go forward. The consent exception has some additional qualifiers that are important in the Yemen conflict context. Consent is limited to particular conduct by another state to the extent that the conduct remains within the limits of the consent given. Hence, an intervening state can only carry out those acts consented by the recipient of the intervention. In addition, consent given by a representative of a state under duress is invalid. So, what that means is that the state can only then do actions that it's authorized to do so by the government that has requested the assistance. And it cannot do so under duress. While we conclude that the primary justification for ongoing military operations in Yemen is consent by the Yemeni government, each form of U.S. military involvement must be analyzed separately to determine whether it triggers Article 2.4 in the first place. If so, the bounds of any consent given, as well as whether the operation could be justified under any of these exceptions. So, the primary justification for the ongoing military operations in Yemen is consent by the Yemeni government. So the Yemeni government, everyone, has consented to the U.S. and to Saudi Arabia and to the Arab coalition to fight the bad guys. This, ladies and gentlemen, is important to remember. Let's move on and move to another point, a part of the legal issues. This is from Lawfare regarding international law. As U.S. support for the Saudi air campaign in Yemen legal issues. And I keep forgetting, but I'm going to post the links to the articles in the chat. And I hope that you all will take a look at them. And this point right here, the U.S. support for the Saudi air campaign in Yemen, the legal issues by Robert Chesney. Look back, and we'll read it here. For the past couple of weeks, and this is back in April 2015, Saudi coalition has been engaged in a substantial air campaign against Houthi forces in Yemen. The United States is not conducting its own airstrikes against the Houthis, but is providing various forms of material and intelligence support to the coalition, including armaments, air-to-air refueling services, satellite imagery, and the posting of a 20-member U.S. military planning cell providing on-site advice and coordination at Saudi operations, including the vetting of targets proposed by the Saudis. So remember, the Saudis aren't just targeting places willy-nilly. They're actually going to America and going to Yemen about these proposed sites that they want to target. Does that support, particularly the vetting of targets, raise any significant legal issues? Some U.S. government officials think so, or at least thought so early on. According to a story from Reuters that ran last Friday, unnamed government source said that data sharing has been extremely minimal in the campaign's early days. This is partly due to legal barriers, the official said. While the United States has used lethal force against an al-Qaeda offshoot in Yemen, it does not consider itself at war with the Houthis. Some officials said that the U.S. administration's analysis is that it lacks the ability under international and U.S. law to collaborate with the Saudis in an offensive against the Houthis. So what might those international and domestic legal issues be? International law and U.S. involvement. The reference of international law as a potential obstacle to U.S. participation in the Saudi-led campaign most likely has to do with Yemen's sovereignty and the U.N. Charter. Might U.S. involvement violate Articles 2-4 provision on the U.N. force? On close inspection, the question is a bit more complicated than seems at first blush. And as we saw earlier, that we know that it's completely legitimate under the rules that allow for this. So right here under the UN Charter, remember, a host state may consent to the use of force in its own territory. Start by considering the position of the Saudis. There is no question that their air campaign is a use of force in Yemen's territory. The Saudis can claim, however, that they have the consent of the legitimate government Yemen in the form of President Hadi sent requesting its military assistance. And hence, Article 2-4 drops out. Some might quibble with the authority of Hadi to make their request, but otherwise, the Saudi position seems strong. So as we can see right here, ladies and gentlemen, the Saudis have fit the bar for a host state may consent to the use of force. So their intervention in Yemen is completely legal under UN Charter and under the exceptions. Because as it states right here, all members shall refrain in their international relations from the threat or use of force against the territorial integrity or political independence of any state or in any other manner inconsistent with the purposes of the United Nations. There are three exceptions to this blanket prohibition, and that the first one is a host state may consent to the use of force. So, as we discussed here in this article, President Hadi, at the time, sent a request to Saudi Arabia requesting assistance. Saudi Arabia came in and fulfilled that request, which is why they are targeting the enemy. So, as you can see right here, there was a public request from Hadi to the Saudis and to the Arab League. The Arab League and the Saudis came in at the request of the legitimate government of Saudi Arabia. And this is not disputed. Wherever you go, you will find that the Saudi intervention in Yemen was totally legitimate, and also is U.S. assistance. In August 2017, Yemen's ambassador to the United States said, "We need the U.S. government to continue to lend its political and legitimate logistical support to the legitimate government and the Arab coalition." That Arab coalition, ladies and gentlemen, being to the Saudis. As we can see right here, also too, Yemen, that no argument can be made against the Saudi intervention on the terms of legality. President Hadi's request, the Saudi-led coalition asked that he use all necessary means to combat the Houthi Salah alliance. Our request arguably includes the U.S. use of military, includes the use of U.S. military assistance. Notably, President Hadi's letter requesting assistance was directed towards specific countries: Saudi Arabia, the United Emirates, Bahrain, Oman, Kuwait, and Qatar, not the international community in general. Any use of force by a state other than those in the letter was addressed, therefore, is a violation of that. Consent, after all, is not transitive. A state that has received consent may not transfer that consent to another state without the permission of the host state. So, then you might say, well, what about the Americans then in Yemen? Well, as we said right here, Yemen has officially requested U.S. support for political and logistical support to the legitimate government of Yemen and the Arab coalition. And in addition, in October 2017, the Yemeni embassy to the United States issued a statement praising the U.S. strategy opposing Iran, which exposes Iran's attempts to use the Houthis to destabilize the region. At the moment, U.S. military assistance to the Saudi-led coalition appears to fall within the scope of the Yemeni government's consent to the actions of the Saudi-led coalition operations. So, as we can see right here, the points that the last writer made, trying to criticize U.S. support of the Saudis in Yemen, is wholly wrong and wholly incorrect. So, let's move on now to some to Yemenis themselves. Because when we're discussing the argument of intervention, which is the point what we're discussing in this first part of the series, which is the legality of it and whether it has support among Yemenis and the regional and international community. We have an article here from the Saudi Press Agency, and the SPA.gov, back in 2000, written in, it appears to be Tuesday, 6/20. This date is a bit confusing to read. Looks like it was written earlier this year, in February 2nd, 2021. Yemeni scholars praise Saudi Arabia's stances with Yemen. A number of scholars of Yemen have expressed their thanks and gratitude to the custodian of the two holy mosques, King Salman bin Abdulaziz Al Saud, and the HRH, the Crown Prince, for the great and continuous efforts made by the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia to support Yemen and confront the Iran-backed Houthi militia. This came in statement after their meeting with the Minister of Islamic Affairs, Call and Guidance, Sheikh Dr. Abdulatif bin Abdulaziz Al-Sheikh yesterday, as part of the periodic meetings of the program of communication with Yemeni scholars. The advisor to the Yemeni president, Dr. bin Musa Al-Ameri, confirmed that the tremendous efforts made by the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia in support of the Yemeni people are appreciated by all the Yemeni people, who realize that the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia is the cornerstone not only for Yemen, but of all Muslims in the world. For his part, the Mufti of Aden, Sheikh Ali Barwais, praised the program of communication with Yemeni scholars, on which the Ministry of Islamic Affairs, Call and Guidance in the Kingdom is based, and considered it a pioneering program that aims to gather the efforts of scholars, preachers, to fulfill their duty to preserve the intellectual and cultural identity of Yemen, appreciated the stances of the Kingdom, and Saudi Arabia with Yemen in all levels. So, as we can see right here, there is a great amount of praise by Yemen's intellectual community regarding the intervention, praising it. So people must understand that this intervention is not only legal by the Human Rights Charter, it is also supported in part by the intellectual community of Yemen, who see that what the Houthis are doing in their country is trying to destroy it, acting as a proxy of Iran, acting as a proxy of the Iranian government in their attempt to destroy and delegitimize the state. So let's go to another article. And I will post again each article I use in the chat, so that way you don't just take my word for it. You can actually look up the references yourself and then come to your own conclusions. Yeah. The Gulf, yeah, that's a good point, Dragon, right there. Gulf states definitely support this conflict, that's for sure, because they're fighting Houthi terrorists who are a proxy of the Iranian government. So let's go back to our articles, and I'm going to also post this at the bottom here. Stop Houthi terrorism in Yemen. It's extremely important that we do that. We're going to continue on to the next article. And this is going to be from Avram Online. Egypt praises Saudi Arabia's efforts to resolve conflict in Yemen. This was written back in 2020. In July. The statement also expressed appreciation for the UAE's role to support a political solution in Yemen. Egypt's foreign ministry lauded the efforts of Saudi Arabia to support the path of a political solution in Yemen, a few hours after the Gulf state presented a new framework to expedite the implementation of the stalled Rijia agreement, aiming to end the crisis in Yemen. In the official statement, on Wednesday, the Egyptian Foreign Ministry praised Saudi Arabia's keenness to implement the Rijia Agreement signed by the Yemeni legitimate government and the Southern Transitional Council in November 2019. So remember, there are different forces in Yemen. There is the Houthi government. There's the Southern separatists. There's ISIL and Al-Qaeda elements in the country fighting. And there's the Houthis. The accord targets reaching a ceasefire, supporting the path of a political solution, activating Yemeni state institutions, and achieving security and stability. The statement also expressed appreciation of the UAE's role to support a political solution in Yemen. So for those who argue that the Saudis and the Arab coalition are just trying to use violence, it is wrong. They have constantly tried to seek out a political solution. But of course, the Houthis don't want one. Egypt welcomed the responsiveness of Yemen's legitimate government and the STC, Southern Transitional Council, to the new mechanism to overcome the current obstacles, give priority to the Yemeni people's interests, and pave the way to resume the political process to reach a comprehensive solution to the crisis in Yemen. The solution has to be in accordance with the Gulf Cooperation Council, the GCC initiative, Yemen's National Dialogue Conference, and the UNSC resolution, said the Egyptian statement. The two Yemeni sides have been fighting in Aden and other southern regions since the STC, the Southern Transitional Council, declared self-rule in April. Rijia wants the two Yemeni sides in the south to focus their common fight against the Iran-backed Houthis that control the north of the territory. And that's extremely true. The Southern Transitional Council and the legitimate government of Yemen need to put aside their differences and fight the common cause against the Houthis. Because if the Houthis win, everyone loses. Both Yemeni sides are nominal allies in the Saudi-led coalition, which has been at war with the Houthis since 2014. I want to make this point. Yemen's been at war for 7 years. At any time, the Houthis could stop the killing and stop the bombing and stop the maiming and come to a political solution. They refuse to. Why? Because they're not interested in the Republican democracy. They're interested only in being a puppet for the Iranians in their war against Saudi Arabia and their war against the West. The Saudi-led military coalition battling the Houthis in Yemen intervened in the conflict-torn country in March 2015 after the Houthis ousted the Saudi-backed internationally recognized government in the capital, Sana'a, in 2014. And to this day, Sana'a still remains in control of the Houthis. And as you can see right here, the Houthis attempted to seize the legitimate government, not through elections, not through the ballot box, but by force. Let's continue on to the next one. So this is to expand on my point earlier that the Saudi coalition and the Saudi intervention is not only legal and supported by Yemenis, but also is supported by regional nations. Egypt supports it. And now we're going to move into why even Turkey supports it. This is part of the movetoturkey.com. And this article was written by Ahmad Ahamwi, and it's titled "Saudi Arabia Seeks Help from from Turkey in the War in Yemen." And before I move on to this article, I'm going to post in the chat for you this article right here. So that way you all can look up this article and review the content. And I definitely will. I appreciate all the people commenting in the chat. Rest assured, after this article, I'm going to come and discuss some of your chats. I do appreciate you guys tuning in. So, Saudi Arabia seeks help from Turkey in the war in Yemen. Turkey officially announced on Tuesday its solidarity with Saudi Arabia in the face of relentless attacks on Ansar al-Islam on Yemeni soil. The Turkish Foreign Ministry said in a statement, "Turkey stands with the Saudi government and people in facing the attacks of Assad supporters on Saudi oil facility." And let's not forget, when it's the Houthis, just like Assad, are proxies of the Iranian government. They are not leaders or of their people. They are nothing more than puppets of the government in Tehran and of the Ayatollahs. According to the Turkish newspapers, the official Turkish statement appears to be the seal of approval for behind-the-scenes issues related to the Turkish-Saudi understanding following Rijia's request from Ankara for military assistance in the Yemeni war and the Battle of Marib. It is unlikely that Ankara has enthusiastically agreed to enter the line of conflict in Marib, especially where the Muslim Brotherhood Reform Party is located alongside Saudi Arabia. Turkey quickly responded to the Saudis' requests, as reports received from northern Syria stated that the fighters from the region were preparing to send to Yemen, as was the case in Libya and Nagorno-Karabakh. If you don't know where this location is, that's a disputed territory between Azerbaijan and Armenia. It was also reported that the Turkish intelligence service began preparing a list of those willing to participate in the Yemeni war with very high salaries and called on groups in Idlib to announce the names and registers of fighters who would be transferred to Yemen for the war with Saudi Arabia. So not only is Turkish intelligence sending support and Turkish nations giving its voice of approval, it's also getting fighters to help fight the Houthi terrorists and fight the Iranian proxies in Yemen. And that's very great. And paying them with very high salaries, which is good. Ankara has also provided Rijia with Carol drones, and the Yemeni army recently announced that it had shot down one of them. According to various sources, Ankara has practically begun transferring a group of military drones to Saudi Arabia to compensate for the cessation of American military support to Saudi Arabia and the failure to equip Rigia with offensive weapons after now President Joe Biden decided to end the Yemeni war and to call for an end. So thankfully, the Turkish nation is stepping up to the plate when America has decided to abandon Yemen to the Houthi terrorists and to Iran. President Joe Biden is so feckless. He has decided that better than helping the Saudi Arabia and the Arab coalition in Yemen and helping the Yemeni people against fighting Iran, he has decided to essentially leave Yemen to the terrorists. That's a recurring thing with Biden. He did the same thing in Afghanistan, abandoned Afghanistan over to the Taliban without even a fight. So pathetic. You know, I just want to say this real quick before I move on to some of the comments in the chat to discuss. The American military did not lose the war in Afghanistan. President Joe Biden and Secretary Blinken and Vice President Kamala Harris lost that fight because they did this, because they did stuff like this. They abandon people who are fighting a good fight against terrorists to themselves under the idea that it will be peace. I'm sorry, but peace with terrorists who want to destroy you is not peace. That is nothing more than simply a mouse trying to negotiate with a snake. And all that will result is that the mouse is simply delaying the time for when it gets eaten. Oh, I didn't realize I still had that comment up. Shoot. It's absolutely pathetic. I don't understand it. But it's sad. But it's really good, though, that at least allies like Turkey are stepping up when the U.S. will not step up, which is terrible. We, the United States, should be stepping up for the people of Yemen. But if they won't, then at least Turkey will. So let's go to some of the comments right here in the chat before we move on to the next video. I'm also going to post the link for the article that we just read so that way you all can take a look at it. So let's go to some of the earlier comments. So this is a good point right here. Dragon Roz, the Houthis caused an insurrection against Saudi. And Saudi Arabia was invited to step in. Well, the Houthis caused an insurrection. The Houthis, yes. So you spelled it wrong. So now I know what you're trying to say. The Houthis, yes. They tried to create an insurrection against the legitimate government. And the Saudis were invited to step in. And we've shown that the legitimate government of Yemen requested the Saudi assistance. We need to help Saudi Arabia to be more accurate with their targets. Obviously correct. We want to help them out in that regard. So we can hit more, we can destroy more Houthi terrorists and Iranian proxies while minimizing civilian casualties. And as soon as Biden has done a ceasefire, the Houthis stormed the U.S. embassy there. Yes, the Houthis have actually taken the U.S. embassy that was in Yemen. There were no U.S. officials there, so it's not going to be a repeat of, you know, the Iranian hostage situation, but the many people who are Yemeni who work there were taken captive, and a couple have been released, but I doubt the rest of them will be released. There's too much leverage for the Houthi terrorists who, you know, commit so many crimes, like, you know, stealing food aid, you know, forcible child recruitment, the use of landmines, and other terrible acts. Dragon Russell says the Houthis have committed war crimes and nobody talks about it. Yes, nobody talks about the Houthi war crimes because it's all about a narrative of supporting Iran. So Saudi Arabia does need help with accuracy, which proves the point. There are no warmongers, correct? That is absolutely correct. So any of those libertarian or lulbertarian isolationists like Rand Paul and democratic socialists, you know, silly socialist tricks are for kids. You know, like Bernie Sanders or or Bum Sanders, you know, trying to tell you that it's all warmongering. They're just fools and idiots. Musa Ali says, do you like Jacob Sartorius? I don't know who that is. You'll have to send me who that is. Right here, the UN does give nations a right to defend themselves. Absolutely true. We just saw right earlier, you know, that the United Nations gives the right of nations to use force and self-defense under Article 51 of the Charter, and also of the UN Charter, and also allows a host state make to consent to the use of force by another outside force in its territory. So what we got right here, show me a safe or for real, you're probably breaking my heart. I don't even know what that means. So this, the Arab is a good asset against Iran. Also, yes, the Arab League is definitely a good asset against the Iranians and against their government. And we definitely need to continue our support for the Arab League. The Gulf states definitely support this conflict. That's for sure. Yes. I mean, the Arab League is comprised of many different nations, and the coalition in Yemen is not just the Saudis. It's also got Egyptian support. As you can see, there are the Turks involved, and also the United Emirates was involved for a time, but now they're more leaning with the Southern Transitional Council, so that has caused problems. And so Lucifer says something many people should remember is that the war at the beginning was a civil war, but now many regard it as a war of Arab liberation from Iran. Yes, the Arabs are fighting a war against Persian-backed proxies. And, you know, I want to see Persia liberated one day from the Ayatollahs who have destroyed their nation and are continuing to destroy their nation. You know, hopefully one day we will see, you know, Persia liberated. Unfortunately, that might not be for a while. But I've always said this, you know, make Iran Persia again. You know, it's time for the, you know, to remove the Ayatollahs. And if the Ayatollahs will lose in Yemen, then that's a greater that strengthens the camp of those in the world and in Iran, in Persia, occupied Persia, who want to liberate the country from the Ayatollahs. And let's see, here's another one. Something many must know is that the war started as a war, but now believe Arab liberation from Iran. Okay, same point. Dragon Rose, the Houthi stormed the U.S. Embassy. That kind of says something. Yes, the U.S. Embassy that was in Sana'a was stormed by the Houthis, and they took hostages, not Americans. No Americans are there. They're all in Saudi Arabia, which just shows you right there, the Saudi Arabians are helping protect U.S. officials from Houthi terrorists, but yet the current government in Washington is more keen to cause problems with the Saudis rather than assist them in their cause, in their fight against terrorists in Yemen, which makes no sense. If Turkey supports Saudi Arabia, man, that would be base, bro. Absolutely, it's base. You know, the Turks are stepping up, you know, where the American government has decided to, again, try to shrink its responsibility to the global community. Man, I really like Turkey now. Well, I'm really happy with what Turkey did, you know. I'm really happy that Turkey is stepping up. Oh, so here's a critical one. Musa Ali says nearly 400,000 people dead, mostly by protestation, mostly killed by the Saudi war criminals. Okay, what a clown. Okay, you want to know what the starvation has been caused by? The Houthis who started the war. You know what the Saudis do? They send tons of food into Yemen. They send tons of food to the civilians, and they send tons of food aid. Why? Because they're trying to save lives. So Musa Ali, have you ever heard of what the Houthis do to the food aid that's been given by the international community that's meant for the civilians starving in their regions? Okay, not in the regions of the government that is supported by the Saudis and supported by the Arab coalition or in the Southern Transitional Council areas, but in Houthi areas. So who's starving the people? It's the Houthis. Have you ever heard of them stealing the food aid and taking it? Yes, there are articles on that. You can look it up. You know, essentially look up the Houthis stealing food aid. And then we have right here, Hawk Takes. Biden delisted the FARC and the Houthis. What's next? The PKK, the Shining Path, the Taliban? Oh, well, more than likely, yes. I mean, it's just so ridiculous. You know, thinks that the Taliban will honor the Doha Agreement, which they didn't, and sees the country literally destroyed, delist the Houthis, who then sees the U.S. embassy in Sana'a and still commit war crimes and still kill people and still starve their own people. And now it delisted FARC. Mike, and you've already seen the protests in Colombia with trying to do pension reform. I mean, FARC is getting extremely active there now that they've been essentially legitimized. I mean, I'm very worried that the country that my mother came from, Colombia, will fall to the communists. You know, Libertad Uribe, we need to get Uribe back so we can purge those FARC terrorists who are destroying the country, you know, who killed members of so many people. And then we got Dragon Rods, these turkeys doing something about something. Yes, they're doing something compared to the United States government, which has decided not to do anything. Biden as well made to list everybody. At this point, yeah, seriously, this is just showing you how feckless President Biden is and how he pretty much is a pawn of the regressive progressives, those isolationist camp who want to essentially delist Islamist groups and left-wing terrorist groups because they simply think that those groups have legitimate grievances. Oh, if we just talk to them and everything will be fine. No, you idiot. These people want to kill you and they want to destroy the nations that they're in and they don't care what happens to the people. Pessimistic Titan, hey, it would not surprise me if Biden delists Hezbollah and Hezbollah. You know what? Just like Hawk Take says, you know, the Houthis got delisted, FARC got delisted. Who knows? You know, Taliban, Hezbollah, that might be next. You know, I would support intervention in Iran also. I would support an intervention in Iran too. You know, I want to make Iran Persia again. You know, restore the Persian monarchy, restore the Persian leadership. You know the legitimate rulers of Iran. Of Persia and liberate it, you know. So let's go back now to our points, to our articles. Let's go back to reading them because I've got a few more here that I want to show you. And I want to appreciate everyone who's listening in and who's been making the comments. I really do appreciate you guys listening in. So let's now go to the next one, the EU. And this is going to be the point I'm making for international community. So we've made the point already that the intervention in Yemen is legitimate under international law. We've made the point that the Yemenis themselves support the intervention. And we've made the point that the regional powers and regional players support the intervention. Now we're going to go to international community, to the EU. So the EU welcomes formation of Yemeni government, praises rule of Saudi Arabia. This is from Dearborn.org. And this is written back in December 2020. Oh, wow. Man, that's my birthday. So the EU welcomed the formation of a Yemeni government on Saturday and praised Saudi Arabia's efforts to achieve the Rijia Agreement. The announcement of a new Yemeni government within the framework of implementing the Rijia Agreement is a positive step forward, toward a comprehensive political solution for the country, a spokesman for the European External Action Service added. The new government will face difficult tasks and will need to take important and courageous decisions for the sake of Yemen and all of its people, the spokesperson added. The spokesperson addressed the importance of having more women in political positions and the effective participation of women in government. Absolutely. We need to ensure that women's rights in the Arabian Peninsula and in the Middle East continue to expand and continue to grow. And only because of American influence has that happened. And so this beats another argument against the non-interventionists and isolationists. The EU appreciates facilitation efforts made by Saudi Arabia and encourages all actors to ensure the prompt and full implementation of all stipulations of the Rijia Agreement, the European spokesman said. France also praised the role by the kingdom to facilitate the Rijia Agreement and implement it. A statement issued by the foreign ministry said that the formation of a new government in the war-torn country is an important step that would contribute to preserving Yemen's unity and territorial integrity. The ministry stressed the importance of ending the conflict in Yemen, which requires a cessation of hostilities and the presumption of discussions under the auspices of the UN to reach a comprehensive political agreement. So not only, ladies and gentlemen, is the Yemeni government praising the Saudi intervention. The Egyptians are praising it. The Turks are praising it and supporting it. And the EU is supporting it. Let's move on to our last article here. Turkey, Egypt join military operations against Houthis in Yemen. So it's not just words, it's actually action. See, because the United States has shrunken back in its role in fighting Islamist terrorism under President Joe Biden, other regional actors are realizing that, you know what, they can't just do it themselves. Oh, sorry, now this article is written back in 2015, so a little older than President Biden, but certainly it still brings to the point that, you know, the regional actors understand that they can't just leave it to the United States to deal with terrorism. They have to bring it up themselves. And this is actually when 2015. Oh, wow. So that's actually when President Obama was president of the United States. Huh? Well, under President Obama, we did shrink some of our roles in the Middle East, which was a bad idea. And that's probably due to then Vice President, now President Joe Biden's influence, you know, the isolationist, regressive, progressive. Anyway, let's read here. Turkey offered its support to Saudi Arabia's military offensive against Houthi rebels in Yemen on Thursday, calling the militia group and its foreign supporters, that being Iran and the Ayatollahs, to stop acting in ways that disturb security and peace in the region. Ankara's foreign ministry said in a statement that Saudi Arabia has informed it of its plans and that the idea was to revive legitimate authority and prevent civil war, news agency Reuters reported. Saudi warplanes continue to bomb the Houthis on Thursday as part of their offensive Storm of Resolve to weaken the Shiite rebels fighting against President Abdel Rabo Mansour Hadi. Foreign naval vessels were additionally sent from Egypt and were expected to reach the Red Sea by Thursday evening to secure the Gulf of Aden after Hadi supporters regained control of its airport from the rebels, which had occupied it on Wednesday. Ah, so there we go, everyone. So it was the Hadi government that requested the Saudis to help them in the naval sphere as well, with regarding to protection of their ports and protection against weapons that the Houthis are trying to get into the country via Somalia through the Iranians. Through the Ayatollahs. Meanwhile, U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry had a conference call with Gulf ministries to discuss the crisis. Kerry commended the work of the coalition taking military action against the Houthis and ensured Washington's support in intelligence sharing, targeting assistance, and advisory and logistical support for strikes against the Houthi. He speaks a different tune now than Biden's president. Morocco, Jordan, Sudan, and the Gulf states have also promised their forces to Saudi Arabia strikes against the Shiite rebels who have gained control of a large part of Yemen's north and driven President Hadi away from the capital, Sana'a. Former President Saleh, who resigned in 2012 after protests, has been accused of backing the rebels. Ah, so even more nations, Morocco, Jordan, Sudan, other Gulf states. So, once again, ladies and gentlemen, and I will post this article, the two articles that we just read in the chat so you can read them. Once again, we are seeing that the only ones who are opposed to this intervention against the Houthis and against the Iranians are isolationist actors. It's not the people in the region, and very often non-interventionists and isolationists will claim, oh, the people don't want us there. They don't support it. It's illegitimate or it's illegal. Well, we've just obviously shredded every single point that they made as completely incorrect and as completely false. I'm going to start to wrap up now. So I'm really glad that you all have tuned in. Just one second. And so we have already proven that the points that the non-interventionist isolationists make, that the action is not legal, is false. We've proven that the Yemeni people themselves wanted the intervention and praised the Saudi intervention. We have proven that the regional community of nearby nations, such as such as Egypt, Morocco, and Turkey, supported the intervention. And we have seen that the international community, including the EU, and at least at one point in time, the United States supported the intervention. That was until the regressive progressives took power. And man, they're just absolutely awful. You know, it's, but this is why, ladies and gentlemen, that we have to support the Yemenis. And here's another, here's a stupid comment. People in Yemen want to kill us, and I wonder if they would still if you weren't over there. You idiot, isolationist. The U.S. being in Saudi Arabia is a good thing. The Saudis, the leadership want us there. And because of U.S. presence in the Middle East, particularly in Saudi Arabia, the country has been reforming, the region has been reforming, and we are there to fight Islamist terrorists, okay, like the Houthis, who are proxies of the government in Tehran, who want to kill innocent people to spread their diabolical version of Islam. And that is why we have to fight the Houthis and fight Iran and support the Saudi intervention. So I do want to thank everyone for coming into this chat and this talk. This is going to be the first part in a six or seven video part series. And I'm hoping to get some individuals from Yemen, like, because I still have yet to figure out how to stream there. But if, hey, if you know how to stream on DLive, you know, please reach out to me via Twitter or somewhere so I can get that set up, because I would love to add my streams to DLive, you know, not just Twitter through Periscope and Twitch and YouTube, but also there. Also subscribe to me on Curious Cat. You know, ask me questions if you have any. I would love to answer them as long as they're appropriate. Also, you can subscribe to me on Gab. I'm not really active there, but if you want, again, you can find all those via my link tree.